COVID-19, homelessness, healthcare, terrorism, global climate change. What do all of these things have in common? They're all wicked problems. In 1973, design theorists published a groundbreaking article defining wicked problem. A wicked problem has innumerable causes, is tough to describe, and doesn't have a right answer. Not only do conventional processes fail to tackle wicked problems, but they may exacerbate situations by generating undesirable outcomes. Global climate change caused by unchecked carbon emissions is, one might argue, the most important wicked problem facing our world today because it threatens the very continued existence of the human race. For years, individual people, individual companies, and individual governments have all made attempts to solve this problem. Why have they failed? Why is this still an unsolved wicked problem? Because it's impossible for one person, one company, or one government to solve this problem. Unilever, regarded as a leader in its efforts to reduce its carbon footprint, stated in a progress report on their sustainable living program, "We are only one company among many, and the change needed to tackle the world's major social, environmental, and economic issues is big and urgent. What's really needed are changes to the broader systems of which we are a part. It's clear that tackling wicked problems demands collaboration and, most importantly, perseverance. As we face global warming as a wicked problem, it's clear that collaboration and perseverance are needed here as well. As the food industry looks to its future, committing to being a part of that collaboration is vital. We are asking today that every food industry company commit to appointing one representative that will be tasked with reporting on your carbon footprint each year to a committee in partnership with the USC FIM program, FMI, and GMA.
Today, our team will be discussing carbon neutrality and the food industry. Here to speak with you are myself, Adrian Gonzalez from Vallarta Supermarkets, Sonia Munoz from Stater Brothers Markets, Karina McLaughlin from Bristol Farms, and Scott Johnson from Dean Foods. Before we begin, we'd like to hear from some of our youngest members of society.
Why are we not mourning the futures lost?
Who will tell them what the bees are?
How flowers looked in the spring?
What the color of green felt like under our feet?
Who will tell the future generations what it was like to see the stars at night?
It is time. Because we are.
We are marching, we are screaming, we are crying. We will make our voices heard. We are the change.
And you will listen.
We'd like to express a tremendous amount of gratitude towards Karina's daughter, Nola, and my younger brother, Alonzo, for narrating.
Thank you, Adrian. The problem of climate change is a wicked problem to which there is no one clear solution. This is not something that individual people, companies, or governments can solve. A collective effort is needed by every person, company, industry, and country. In our food industry, we need to collectively work on solutions because we contribute to the problem through our supply chain, our energy usage, and our contributions to food waste. If we do not begin to accelerate our efforts, we will lose the next generation of customers and talented employees who will demand it. If action isn't taken, we will risk that governments will increase regulations in order to force action. Taking steps to self-regulate is our best option. Over the next few minutes, we're going to explain how the food industry contributes to the problem of climate change, how our consumers, employees, and investors will demand that we make a change, and lastly, that if we don't make changes, our government will step in and regulate. Now let's focus on how the food industry is contributing to the problem, starting with transportation. It takes 13 trees 100 years to remove the carbon dioxide from one delivery to your store. Globally, transportation represents 19% of total energy use. And in the United States alone, transportation represents approximately 29% of total greenhouse emissions. Transportation emissions have been increasing for the last 30 plus years and are only expected to grow 30 to 40% by the year 2050. Most recently, on-demand deliveries are exploding, and it is resulting in more deliveries that are often far less efficient.
According to Energy Star, there are approximately 40,000 supermarkets in the United States. Refrigeration and lighting counts for 50% of stores' energy usage. Each store uses approximately 50 kilowatt hours of electricity and 50 cubic feet of natural gas per square foot per year. These costs accumulate to approximately $4 per square foot. It is very important that all stores, distribution centers, and warehouses look into natural lighting and only opening refrigerated coolers when necessary in order to conserve energy. An average 50,000 square foot supermarket spends $200,000 on energy costs, resulting in 1,900 tons of CO2 emissions. One 50,000 square foot store emits the same amount of carbon emission from 360 cars a year. Many companies have invested millions of dollars replacing their lights with LED lights, along with the addition of doors on open refrigeration cases. However, these investments are merely a starting point to addressing the bigger issue. Food waste is another example on how the food industry is contributing to carbon emissions. Not only is it costly to the environment, it's an expense that all individuals inherit as well. 30 to 40% of all food is wasted and is valued at approximately $165 billion annually. A very unrealistic goal, however, if Earth were to eliminate food waste completely, we would be able to lower greenhouse gas emissions by approximately 8%. Food waste is a serious problem, as the food industry needs to tackle this issue to stop the bleeding environmentally and financially. If food waste was represented as its own country, it would be considered the third largest greenhouse gas emitter, directly behind China and the United States. We need to understand that these are big factors and ways we are contributing to the carbon emission problem. Karina will now explain how employees, consumers, and investors will demand our companies to make strides against carbon emissions.
First, let's take a look at the evolving demographic of the U.S. consumer. Today, adult Gen Z and millennials make up 36% of the adult population of the U.S. By 2040, they'll be 49%. And if you add in Generation Alpha, that shoots up to 65%. Millennials are the most racially and ethnically diverse adult generation in the nation's history and came of age during the internet explosion, while Gen Z is on track to be even more diverse and even better educated. Not only are their sheer numbers going to become a factor to business, but their purchasing power will as well. Currently, millennials hold $323 billion in purchasing power and will surpass the spending power of Gen Xers by the end of this year. Generation Z is on target to surpass that once they all enter the workforce. With the increasing importance of millennials and Generation Z to the food industry, based on their pure percentage of the population and their purchasing power, it's vital that the food industry find ways of speaking to the issues that these consumers care about. Recent studies show that 64% of Gen Z and 69% of millennials believe it's worth it to pay more for products that don't harm the earth. They also rank sustainability as the fourth most important factor when deciding whether to purchase a brand again. This metric ranks only behind quality, price, and convenience. In order to better understand the purchasing behaviors of grocery consumers, we surveyed a group of 275 adult grocery shoppers consisting of Generation Z, Millennials, Generation X, and Baby Boomers. Our findings mirror what we've seen in other studies and provided us with some valuable firsthand data on what factors shoppers deem important in regards to carbon emissions and environmental sustainability. We found that 100% of Gen Z and 70% of millennial respondents would pay more for groceries based on its carbon footprint, compared to only 54% of Gen X and 60% of baby boomers. 73% of millennials said that a company's environmental sustainability practices affect their purchase decisions, compared to 59% of Gen X and 58% of baby boomers. When asked how do you feel about food companies' environmental responsibility and their impact on climate change? One millennial respondent stated, "It is not optional. I believe companies have a responsibility to society to do business in a way that is focused on sustainability." With all the focus on millennials and Gen Z, it's easy to overlook what promises to be the most diverse, best educated, and most affluent generation in US history. Generation Alpha is defined as those born after 2010, meaning that the oldest of this cohort are only 9 to 10 years old right now. By 2040, Generation Alpha will make up at least 16% of the adult population. They're the children of millennials and possess similar behaviors, attitudes, and beliefs. Although this generation is currently comprised of children, they have a large effect on the spending habits of their parents. In fact, 81% of US millennial parents say that the habits of their alpha children influenced their latest purchase. In 2019, a study was conducted researching the opinions and behaviors of Generation Alpha. What was found was that Gen Alpha already have very strong opinions. They attribute high importance to some very serious topics. 95% of them feel that taking care of the environment is of high importance, outranked only by keeping children safe at school and making sure everyone has enough food to eat. Most surprising in this research was the finding that 1 out of 5 children, ages 5 to 9, have attended their first march or protest about something they care about, and half of their parents encourage them to speak out as activists. Keeping all this in mind, it's clear that Gen Alpha are sure to have some strong opinions, which will shape the world that they live in. Not only is it vital that companies react to the demands of consumers, but also to their prospective employees. Over the next 5 years, millennials will make up 3/4 of the US workforce, and Gen Z is expected to make up 30%. In 2019, 70% of millennials said they prefer to work in a company with a strong sustainability agenda. And 75% would be willing to take a smaller salary to work for an environmentally responsible firm. Gen Z is referred to as the change generation for their passion and desire to have a personal impact through their work. More than half of Gen Z say that they want to pursue careers in public service or the nonprofit sector. In a study of 11 million employee comments done by employee feedback company Peakon, Gen Z respondents were the only generation to reference social concerns within their comments. Raised in a time when the effects of climate change are making weekly headlines, it shows that they care deeply about the world around them. In another study, 90% of Gen Z adults and 93% of millennials consider making the world a better place a must-have or a nice-to-have in their ideal workplace. While taking a stand inevitably involves trade-offs, the positives can outweigh the negatives if you calibrate your stance to the issues your specific workforce is most passionate about. A corporate social responsibility program of environmental sustainability might do more than combat climate change. It could ally your company with a very demanding generation as well. And as stated by Casper Helfen, founder of Peakon, it's not enough to simply have a recycling bin in the kitchen anymore.
In addition to our consumers and employees, the investment community is also demanding change. Investment climate change is happening. The investment community is moving with you or without you. Earlier this year, Larry Fink, the CEO of the world's largest money manager, sent a letter to other CEOs around the world in which he wrote, "There is no denying the direction we are heading. Every government, every company, and every shareholder must confront climate change. Risk and asset values are changing. The capital allocations will move faster than climate change itself. BlackRock is committed to change and others will follow. The investment community is no different than us. They must collaborate and coordinate collectively to force change. Fink clearly calls on the governments to lead the way to a fair and just low carbon transition. The climate challenge cannot be solved without a coordinated and international response from governments. What is the government's next move? Now that we've talked about the importance of environmental issues to consumers, employees, and investors, I'm going to turn it over to Sonia to talk about the regulations and the value of self-regulating.
Governments around the world are stepping in and shifting the burden of this wicked problem to those responsible for it by placing a price on carbon. By placing a carbon tax or implementing a cap and trade system that provides emission allowances, the government is creating a supply and demand for allowances and is establishing a market price for greenhouse emissions. Businesses in over 40 countries, more than 20 cities, states, and provinces around the world are paying the price for their contribution to pollution. This global effort combined represents about half of their emissions, which translates to 13% of the annual global greenhouse gas emissions. The government recognizes this effort, but ultimately this is not sufficient and acknowledges that it is not enough to impact the problem. They are planning to further expand taxing policies and influence other countries to participate in similar practices. In 2018, the United States ranked second amongst other countries for their contribution to carbon emissions. Lawmakers and climate groups recognize the need for strict guidelines and are asking for the government to step in and help regulate carbon emissions. The following bills are being introduced to the House and Senate to reduce the carbon in the atmosphere. The Stemming, Warming, and Augmenting Pay Act sets a tax of $30 per metric ton of carbon dioxide. The Market Choice Act sets a tax on carbon of $35 per ton. The Clean Future Act has undisclosed penalties to companies who don't reduce their emissions. And the Raise Wages Cut Carbon Act that proposes a tax of $40 per ton on carbon dioxide. A tax of $40 per ton would add about 36 cents to the price of a gallon of gasoline. As we heard Scott discuss earlier, transporting one truckload of goods emits 3.25 tons of carbon dioxide. If the Raise Wages Cut Carbon Tax Bill is passed, the $40 per ton price tax on carbon will cost you $130 per truckload. If the government steps in, they will define the cost that will impact your business. The time is now, and the best suited to take action are those that know the most about their business. With your experience, you have an opportunity to put our industry on a more environmentally sustainable path. Many of you are already taking steps to reduce your carbon footprint. Each year, a group of more than 75 businesses, including 21 Fortune 500 companies, have joined with federal lawmakers to pass stronger climate legislation. Lawmaker Education and Advocacy Day, known as LEAD, is the largest business gathering advocating for climate legislation. CEOs of major companies such as Nestle, Mondelez, PepsiCo, and many others are sharing their solutions with Congress to tackle the climate change. They are proposing a national price on carbon across the American economy that will include retailers, manufacturers, food, and beverage companies. We recognize that you are making an effort, but to solve this wicked problem, it is going to take all of you. It is going to take a collaborative approach. We will need to take everyday actions that add up to big differences. By implementing your own sustainable strategy, you have an opportunity to project a favorable image to those consumers and employees who value it. Your commitment to a more environmentally sustainable business cannot be done alone. The Environmental Protection Agency, or EPA, has partnered with programs to support businesses with their commitment to decrease their carbon footprint. Green Shield program assists over 350 food retailers and businesses in transitioning to an environmentally friendlier refrigerants to lessen the impact on the ozone layer and climate change. If all supermarket chains in the United States met the Green Shell average of 13.9%, the industry would cut its annual refrigerant emissions by 30 million metric tons of carbon dioxide. This would save you $156 million annually on refrigerant replacement costs. Another voluntary program is Energy Star program, which places focus on reducing energy use through the efficiency of homes and businesses. In 1 year, this program has helped avoid $35 billion in energy costs and has helped Americans' emission reduction by 330 million metric tons of greenhouse gases, equivalent to gas emissions of 152 million cars.
Today, we have discussed how the food industry contributes to this problem in significant ways that damages the environment. We explained that our consumers, employees, and investors will demand that we make a change. Finally, we stated that if we don't make these changes ourselves, government will begin to regulate at a higher level. We ask you all to commit to appointing one representative that will be tasked with reporting your carbon footprint each year to a committee in partnership with FIM, FMI, and GMA. We want the food industry to come together as a coalition to tackle the wicked problem that is carbon emissions. We need your assistance in creating a scorecard that FIM, FMI, and GMA can assist with the sustainability of carbon neutrality. On behalf of Team Ecolution, thank you very much for your time. We hope you all stay safe and enjoy the rest of your day.